Campfire Ministries. Glad you can make it to watch. I'll tell you what, man, I've been taking a look around at this world, man. Things are getting worse out there, man. It's dark forces are definitely rising. When you got a fundraiser going and you sit there and on a website that counts that'll actually count your visits and shows you the numbers of how many people back you and everything else, and it's a Christian fundraiser, it's an event that's going to bring godliness into a town of all things, and you're showing well over 100,000 visitors and only $2 funded. That's getting to be pretty bad. That's pretty dark. That's pretty evil right there in itself. Not to mention the genocide and stuff that's going on in this world. The way the economy is getting bad. And more and more people are getting money happy. The more the rich are getting and the elite getting money happy. You got a lot of Satanism in the music of today. A lot of Satanism and devil worship, and some of it's even borderline pornography in music that our kids listen to. Man, things are getting bad, bottom line. I'm going to talk about that a little bit in this message tonight. So let's go ahead and open up in some prayer and see where God leads us on this. Dear Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for this day. And Lord, I just want to ask that you just hide me behind the cross, Lord. Just make it to where people don't even hear my voice, but they hear your voice speaking through me. Lord, just use me as a vessel, Lord, to spread the message of hope and salvation to those out there in this lost and dying world, and in a world where dark forces are rising. And I come against those dark forces right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, I just want to ask that you just lead and guide and direct me, and don't let me speak not one word that you do not want me to speak. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, let's go ahead and get started here. Like I said, there's all kinds of stuff. I mean, you look at the media, you don't hear nothing but bad stuff in the media most of the time anymore. It's all drama and stuff that's just ungodly. I mean, it's, come on, people. It's, you know, people need to wake up. I mean, when dark forces are rising, and we need this, we must stand up. If you're already a Christian out there, you need to stand up. You must stand up for Christ in these days ahead, in these times ahead, because it's only going to get worse, people. So that's, and you know, I hear, you know, of course, you know, there's a popular belief out there, you know, we're going to be raptured out of here. You know, it's, now personally, I don't believe that, but that's not what this message is about. That's neither here nor there. But it's Christians are already being killed across seas, some even here. I know of one Christian I can't say that I've met him face to face, but because of some of his messages and some of what he teaches, he's very dear to me. And some of y'all may know him, Kent Hovind. He's been in jail for several years for because of his faith. They're claiming other reasons, but it's because of his faith. They can't prove these other reasons in court, but yet they're still keeping him in jail. So let's go ahead and get into some scripture and find out why. What is it that we're fighting up against? What are these times about? What are these times are coming up? Why is there so much evil in the world this day? Well, you know, Jesus told us that these things would happen just before he came and returns. If you go into the book of Matthew, in Matthew 24, there's quite a bit on that, and that you'll get. That you'll see if you start in Matthew 24, we'll start about, let's see, about verse, we'll start about verse 2. I will just go ahead and start about verse 1, and I'll just read until God tells me to stop on this, and I'll break down as I hit certain key points here. And as Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to show him, the buildings of the temple. Jesus said unto them, See you not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left one here. There shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. As he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the end of the world? And Jesus said unto them, here's where things get ugly. Okay, as I read these next few scriptures here, I want you to take a look at the media, take a look at what's going on around you and evaluate this, and let me know if this describes anything you've seen. Take no heed that no man deceives you. Many shall come in my name. Again, this is an evil. We're coming into all this stuff. We're already in all this, a lot of this stuff. Many shall come in my name, saying that I am Christ, and shall deceive many. You know, listen to this. So many will come in the name of Christ, claiming Jesus is the Christ, but they'll deceive a lot of people. How is that so? How can you do that? Very easy. Oh, okay. I'm a servant of Christ. Give me all your money and you'll get to heaven. That's one way. And there's thousands of other ways. Listen to me. We got, you know, darkness. That's dark forces rising. And you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See, okay, have y'all heard of, how many wars have you heard of, that's going on? How many wars have you heard that may be going on, but there's no evidence of it? That's rumors of war. So, we're on the brink of, we've been on the brink of nuclear war for a long time. See that you be not troubled, for these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. What are you seeing in the world today? You're seeing nation rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. And pestilence and earthquakes in diverse places. Man, we've had some of the weirdest weather patterns here lately that I've ever seen. but all these are the beginning of sorrows. Now that's just the beginning of sorrows. Now, here in verse 9, in Matthew 24:9, we're coming into the tribulation. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted. In Kent Hovind's case, the ISIS. Look at ISIS. They've killed thousands of Christians. You know, marching through these Christian camps and over in the east, over there in Iraq and in those places, and already killed many people, and run them out of their places. Ran them out of their homes. And shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. Now think about this. Going back to the fundraiser I was talking about, which of course is the JesusFest fundraiser, and I'll get into more detail of that at the end of the message here. But being hated of all nations, you know, when you get online and you mention, you sit there and come against some ungodliness, you mention anything, show any scripture stands against things that are of the world this day and time, you get ridiculed for it. It opens a can of worms anymore. You know, back 10 years ago, you told somebody homosexuality was wrong, they would halfway listen to you. Now it's like, no, it's not, and you know, throw it right back in your face and come up with all kinds of reasons why it's not wrong and everything else when God says that it is. bottom line, and then also the fundraiser issue. I mean, it's you sit there, you get on there. If you started a fundraiser today, you get on there and start a fundraiser for any kind of event, for any reason, any charitable type reason, starting a business, something like that. Let's just use this fundraiser I got going for an example. You put up a fundraiser that says God Fest, Jesus Fest, it's promoting God. It's going to be hard to get funding for it this day and time. I'm living proof of that. You put up a Lady Gaga or Marilyn Manson fundraiser, I guarantee it, within weeks you'd have it funded. That is evil, people. That is proof that of dark forces rising. They're rising out, and they got dark forces coming straight from the gates of hell, and they're influencing our people. But now here's the question: what are we as Christians doing about that? I'm going to keep reading. And many false Christs and prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. Okay, you got a bunch of Christians out there that are claiming to be Christian, but yet they don't do nothing when it comes to the evil of the world. To me, that's a false Christ. That's a false prophet right there, a false minister. You got all these TV ministers out there that are preaching, give your life to Christ, but yet when it comes to preaching them, you know, there is a hell. And that if you don't have Christ in your heart, and that you're going to go there, then, you know, when it comes to preaching and stuff like that, they won't do it. They want to tickle your ears. Now, when it comes to most churches, even around here, I'm in an area right now where I've already submitted my fundraiser to about 20 or 30 different churches in my area and surrounding areas. I've only got two that even remotely showed any interest in backing me on this thing. Okay, so you tell me that's not dark forces influencing our churches. Okay, even I got several people around in this. I've seen we're living in a time where when somebody needs help, goes walking into a church begging help, you know, begging for help. You know, maybe their lights are, you know, about to get turned off or rent's due or something. They go into a church oftentimes begging for help, and they're turned away. Why is this? Could it be the times that we're living in? We're allowing that the men and women of the true men and women of God are allowing these dark forces to creep in and influence them. Could that be what's going on? Because I mean, because back in the church, you know, there was a time to where when something ungodly came into a community somewhere, all the church of that community, in that community, the men and women of God, the Christians in that area, the ones that stood for Christ, well, they would protest if they had to. Why don't we do that today? We need to be doing that today. You want to see this nation healed? That's part of how you do it. Okay, now let's keep going on. And then, and many false prophets shall rise and deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, and the love of many shall wax cold. There's the reason right there. Because iniquity has abound this day and time. Rumors may have started and caused people to go bitter and stuff. Okay, you got to look past that people, that stuff sometimes, folks. And keep your eyes on Christ. Don't let iniquity grow on you. And because iniquity shall abound, and the love of many shall wax cold. Okay, now, let me ask you something. If you're a man of God or a woman of God, if somebody comes to you in need, whether it's a believer or non-believer, it doesn't matter. If they come to you in need, and you have it to give, so why is, you know, what is it that keeps you from giving? A lot of times, oh, I don't know that person, okay, but what does Jesus say about that? Give to them that ask. And then how are you to lead people to Christ if you can't do that? If you don't have, at least have the heart to get it, do it. I can understand if you don't have it to give. Because I've been in that situation myself where, you know, where I wanted to give stuff and just didn't have it to give. That's understandable, and God understands that. But you can at least pray for them, take them in, and maybe try to point them somewhere to where they can get their physical needs met. That's what I try to do. I'll give you an example. There's a lady in our community here recently. The storm took her roof off, part of her roof off. She couldn't find help nowhere. So it just so happens that the church that I attend, many of y'all know, I'm founder of Camp Fire Ministries, but I attend Trinity Baptist Church in Manning, Louisiana. But the church I attend happens to be one of those churches that are so spirit-filled that they bend over backwards to try to help those that are in need, whether they're members or not non-members. So you want to fill your church? Start doing things like this. But continuing on. But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. So how are you saved through all these perilous times? How do you keep your faith? You hold on to your faith all the way until the end. You do your best to do what God tells you to do. And that's a big one, is helping people. And the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And then shall the end come when you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel prophet standing in the holy place. Then let him which is in Judea flee to the mountains. Let him which is on the housetop come down. So yeah, there's the world right there. Now, what is it that causes all this? Why is there so much turmoil, and how do we deal with it? Let's go take a look at Ephesians now. If you're going to turn with me to Ephesians chapter 6. Okay, let's go and turn in here. That's like I said, the world's the way it is because people have lost their faith and not even realized it. The church has lost it, has turned their back on God and don't even realize it for the most part. There's only a handful of people that are like myself anymore that are willing to step out and do what they what they're supposed to do. Now you got to remember too, folks. There's scripture in the Bible that says not everybody who cries, "Lord, Lord," will enter and will make it to heaven. That bottom line, not everybody cries that. It's he that hears and does the will of his Father. Those are the people that are going to make it in these times. Those are the people that are going to shine in these times. And those are the, and it's by faith that we make it to heaven. It's by faith that we're even that we make it through hard times, people. Yeah, I know times are hard and they're going to get harder. The economy's crashed. This whole nation right now is in turmoil. It's broken. It's sick right now, and it's I'm going to let you know up front. Whenever we do Jesus Fest, I'm going to get into some of that. I'm going to get into to what's going on in the nation and how to fix it. just to kind of give you a hint on our theme there. Okay, but now going into Ephesians 6, let's find out what the influence of the world is right now. Starting in Ephesians 6, starting at verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, and against spiritual wickedness in high places. So there's our issue right there. So men and women of God, fellow servants of Christ, fellow brethren, fellow sisters, all those that claim to love Jesus, wake up! Start standing up against Satan. Start standing up against the enemy. Start doing what it takes to get focused back on Christ. Okay, let's take a look at how much evil this world and how evil this world's on the verge of getting right now. Let's go to I'm going to come back to Ephesians here in just a minute, but you come to me to the book of Revelations chapter 13, and let's see how dark things are about to get, because you're already seeing stuff like this all over the internet, some of it on the news and everything else, and what I'm about to read out of here. We have an Antichrist rising. That's the rise of like I said, dark powers rising. I mean, you see Satanism in our music. You see it on the news. You see it in almost all the movies. You see references to Illuminati and Freemasonry everywhere, which is a Luciferian doctrine, which is the doctrines of Satan. And the Bible stands out clear on those. All this fornication and sex and adultery that's being pushed in our TV shows or movies. Some of it may not be so blatant, some of it's subtle, but if you pay attention, you'll still see it. And it's getting more and more blatant, people. So we need to stand up against this stuff, vote against stuff if we have to. Now, if you come with me into the book of Revelations, I'm going to talk where it talks about... and it says, it's talking about, okay, it's going to be Revelation 16 is going to be my focal on here. But but I'm going to go back a little bit and kind of give you some background on what's going on here. Okay, now in Revelation 13, it's talking about the beast that rises out of the sea, and it talks about a second beast that gives power to the first beast, and the beast also calls it, and coming in to see how dark things are getting. You hear a lot of talk about this microchip implant. People, that's the mark of the beast. Bottom line, point blank, that's the mark of the beast, and it may not be the final product just yet, but it is the mark of the beast. But and he that causes all, both small and great. Actually, he had it talks about here the beast was given power. And the beast had power to give life into the image of the beast, and the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many would not worship the image of beast should be killed. Okay, what kind of person would want to kill a Christian? Because those that won't worship the image of the beast, those are going to be mostly Christians, people. Right here it says that those that would not worship the beast will be killed. So, and he caused all both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand and in their forehead. Yes, you know, I made a reference, and there's two references at the beginning of this video when it's coming on before I started speaking. There's two picture references. One was, you know, basically Obama showing, you know, like a creepy-looking, evil-eyed, glowing-eyed Obama with a couple of soldiers controlling the masses. And the other one was showing a guy that's getting a microchip implanted and playing his hand. Both small and to receive a mark in their right hand. Now, I want you to pay attention to that picture on the mark, which hand that's going in. That lines right up with Scripture, folks. Now, you tell me there's not a dark, you know, that dark forces aren't rising. And Christians, we need to stand up to that, myself included. We need to stand up and we need to stand strong in prayer, stand strong in Christ, and start doing whatever it takes to try to lead as many people to Christ as we can in these times. That's how you stand against this stuff. You lead people to Christ. And then, when you see in Oklahoma where they're putting a statue for Satan in Oklahoma City, that needs to be protested against. And the men and women of God, the churches in that area need to come up and stand and go and protest and have that torn down. That's what I'm talking about by we must stand up again and stand up for Jesus through these times. People, we're in a war. We're in a war against Satan. We're in a war against powers and principalities and wickedness and high places. Let's go back to Ephesians now. Moving back to Ephesians. And let's go back to that focal verse, and I'm going to go a little bit deeper in that. As I was saying, we are literally at war against Satan and his minions. Those are supernatural forces. But you know what? We serve a God that's bigger than that. So don't be afraid to stand. And if you don't know Christ, give your life to Christ today. Give it. We have but a short time before things wind down in this world. So we need to. And so what you need to do is, I'm going to go ahead and read that focal verse again. So going into Ephesians 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities, against rulers of darkness of this world, and against spiritual wickedness in high places. That's what we're up against. Okay, now what do we do to fight that? How do we fight that? Okay, so first thing you got to do, you got to remember, if you go back up to verse 9, and you have, and you masters do the same things unto them, forbearing, threatening, okay. Going down to verse 9, towards the end of the verse, the thing you got to remember. Knowing that your master is also in heaven. Neither is there respect of persons with him. In other words, he's not a respecter of man. God's God, and his rules always stay the same, regardless. He's going to carry out just punishment to those that is due. Finally, my brethren, okay, here's how you fight this stuff. Be strong in the Lord and in prayer. And in the power of his might, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand the wiles of the devil. So this is, now we're starting to get into how you fight the Christians, men, women, and God. Take heed to that verse. And then there's our focal verse. And watch this. It's going to go back into our focal verse now. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, and against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God. Okay, well, what's the armor of God? Let's see what that is. That you may be able to withstand in the day of the evil day, having done all to stand. So, okay, once you've done all you can do to try to knock these idols down, to knock these people down, and you've already spoken to your blue in the face and try to lead them to Christ, then you stand on your principles. You stand on what you know is right. What God has taught you, what Jesus has taught you through the Scriptures. Everything that God teaches you is going to come, it's going to be back, you can back it with Scripture. Everything. throughout your whole life. You can back, if it's godly, you can back it with the scriptures. So you stand up against his weakness. You got to remember, you resist the devil and he has to flee. Excuse me. But stand therefore, having your loins girded up with about truth. Here's the armor of God. And you got your loins girded up about with truth. And you have on the breastplate of righteousness. And your feet shrouded with the preparation of the gospel of peace. So in other words, you be a peacemaker through all this at the same time. And you know, whenever I say stand up against the falsehoods and ungodliness is being taught in this world, it don't mean go with a shotgun and try to blow their heads off. It means go and protest signs or whatever you got to do to protest it. You know, go to those polls and vote it down. Write letters to your Congress. Tell them, hey, you don't want these ungodly laws in your land. And stuff like that. You're free. And you get enough people doing that, it's gonna cause some fuss and knock some of these laws down. Prayer being taken out of schools, that's evil in itself. But your feet shrouded with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith. See, faith is a shield for you people. That's the one that blocks those fiery darts of Satan. It blocks what he throws at you. So you got a shield of faith of Christ. And Jesus is saying, you have your faith in Christ, there's your shield. And he's going to help you stand your ground. Wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. You know, I notice the word there is in lowercase, so it's not talking. It's not a direct reference to Jesus, like in the word being capitalized. The sword of the Spirit is the Bible. And how do you use it? You read it daily. You don't necessarily have to carry it around everywhere, but have it memorized, because you're able to speak those scriptures. And the sword is your tongue of the Word of God. So in other words, you go out there, you go to a non-believer that, you know, someone's living in sin, hey, look, brother, there's a better way of doing things, man. There's a better life out there for you than going and carousing in these bars and sleeping around doing the drugs and, you know, running and living a life of fear. You know, Jesus don't give a spirit of fear, but he gives a spirit of peace and a sound mind. Is that what you want? When you go and tell somebody stuff like that, that's that sword. That's cutting Satan all the pieces right there. So you go out there and do stuff like that, and you start watching transformation in your area. And see, these sermons that I do on here, my ultimate goal, this ain't about me, it's not about money, it's about spreading Jesus, people. It's about giving people a fair warning on what's to come, to those that don't have Jesus, and giving them the opportunity to accept Christ. You know, Christ, it's not God's will that any should perish. In other words, God don't, it's not the Father's will that any should perish. That's why he sent Jesus, but have everlasting life. You know, Satan was originally created hell was originally created for Satan and his angels. And so, the fact that, if we get thrown there with Satan, and his angels, due to the rejection of Christ, how much worse is that going to be on us? Look, folks, Jesus loves you. Bottom line, Jesus loves you, and he just wants you to come to him. Now, I'm going to close with this, we just knew, if you're a Christian out there, you need to stand up. You need to stand up and do the right things, and you need to start to everybody has their struggles, myself included. I don't claim to be perfect by any means. Just forgiven by Christ. I know that's why we have a need for a Savior, people. I don't claim to know it all. Not perfect by any means. I'm just willing to do whatever I can to serve Christ. Do whatever I can to please Jesus. I try to be obedient as I can. I'm not perfect at it. We all have our screw ups. So here's the thing, as a non-believer, you really ain't got much choice. You ain't got no you have no way to nothing spiritually to back you. and to knock down those things of Satan, and it's easier for you to be influenced. It's a lot easier for you to be influenced. He's gonna whisper in your ear, and you just kind of give in, you know. Hey, look, you know, Satan might whisper in your ear, hey, look at that beautiful blonde over there, or, you know, look at that hot guy over there, you know, don't you want him? You know, something like that, and it all starts from there, and then next thing you know, you find yourself doing stuff you shouldn't do. Well, guess what? When you have Christ, Satan comes up, hey, look at that hot blonde over there. It's like, Satan, I used to be in that lifestyle, I know what it's all about, get behind me in the name of Jesus. And guess what he's going to do? He's going to get behind you. It gives you a leg up. You don't have to live that lifestyle now. Are you going to be perfect from accepting Christ? No. Are you still going to screw up? Yes. But are you going to begin to grow into a better person? Absolutely so. As long as you keep your eyes on Christ, you're going to find yourself in a whole new life that's way better than what you did before. And you're going to have people hate you for it, because we live in a world where dark forces are rising. And that's how you, and the way you overcome that is through Christ, simply through Christ. You know, Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice, and they obey me whatever I ask of them. So that's the best decision you can ever make in your life is giving your life to Christ, people. Okay, and I'm going to end it with that, and go ahead and end in prayer, and I'm going to give a few announcements after prayer, and we'll close it from there. By the way, are you a Christian? If you're not, please consider giving your life to Christ. It'll be the best choice you ever made. It's well worth it. But you also want to realize when you give your life to Christ, you're stepping into a war. And you're stepping into a war against these dark forces that are rising in the world today. These dark forces are only going to get bigger. All the way up until Christ returns, it's only going to get they're going to get bigger. So the best thing you can do is give your life to Christ and be ready for it. And you know, that's the best way to be ready for these times to come, is to know who Jesus is. Because then you're in a win-win situation. These dark, you know, all man can do is the worst thing that man can do to you is take this body. I mean, they can take everything, all your material belongings away from you, can take everything away from you. And they can even take your body, but guess what they cannot take? They cannot take your soul. They cannot take your faith away from you. They can't take none of that away from you. So, you know, the scripture says, no man can pluck you from the Father's hand. Well, guess what that's talking about? That means once you've given your life to Christ, it's then up to you, it's only by your own choice that whether or not you keep that faith or not. The best thing you can do is give your life to Christ, because that's going to guarantee you give your life to Christ and begin to live for Him. Strive with all your might to walk as Christ did. How do you find out what Christ did? It's written in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and James in the King James Version Bible. And I highly recommend King James over all the rest. And that's a whole other subject. I'll get into that one later. Let's go ahead and end the singing prayer. And everybody have a good end. And I'll, like I said, got just a few announcements I'll make. And go from there. Dear Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for this day, Lord. And Lord, I just want to pray that if there's anyone out there that needs you today, Lord, that they either contact me or go find a local church at Spirit Field or whatever it takes, Lord, just bring them to you, Lord. Bring them to the altar, Lord. Lord, I just want to thank you for using me as a vessel. Though I'm unworthy in so many ways, Lord, you still use me, Lord. And for that, I'm grateful and I'm thankful. And Lord, though I'm imperfect, far from being perfect, I just thank you for just always using me for your will, Lord. And Lord, I'm going to go ahead and after I pray this, Lord, I'm going to go ahead and do kind of a video altar call, so to speak, and just hope and pray somebody out there does not know you and gives their life to you, or maybe somebody will call me needing prayer. If nothing else, maybe they just need to be prayed for. But Lord, I'm going to let you lead them to let you be the judge on who needs to be dealt with and who don't, Lord. Let your Spirit lead and guide them, Lord. Just tug at their hearts if they need it, Lord, the watchers of this video to do what you want them to do, Lord. whether it be call me or just simply pray on their own. It doesn't matter. Lord, you know their hearts. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Okay, as I said, as I prayed in that prayer just then, I'm gonna open it. I'm going to kind of open it and let you know if anybody out there needs Christ, feel free to call me. Feel free to call my wife, Mary. I believe she's already gone to bed for the evening. Oh, man, that's... sorry for the tears here. You know, as I'm oftentimes as I'm praying, as I'm doing the video, I'm thinking about the condition of the world, knowing how it tears God, even God apart to see it like this, seeing things going on the way it does, and you know, my heart cries out to the lost, just like Jesus' heart cries out to the lost. And but I'm gonna let you know now, if you've never accepted Christ, I want you to pray this prayer with me. But don't pray just because I'm praying. Pray it from your heart. So, dear Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for this day, Lord. Lord, I know that I'm a sinner. And I now know that you died on the cross for my sins. And then I know that you're the only one that can erase those sins and forgive me for it, Lord. Lord, I'm sorry for what I've done to against you and against my fellow brothers and sisters. I'm sorry for for anything I've done wrong in my entire life. And I ask that you just wipe it clean, Lord, and come into my heart and live in my heart and make me a new creature that serves you, Lord. And help me to stand on your word and give me guidance and wisdom the rest of the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer, I want to hear from you. So if you can just feel free to comment in the comment boxes below. Feel free to. I'm going to leave all my information in the comment box below. Going to be some information in the credits at the end of this video as well. Now, moving right along, we do. The fundraiser is still going on for JesusFest, and I mentioned it earlier in the video. Is what's going on with it and stuff. That shows how evil it is. One of many things. It's just one of many things that shows where this world's gotten. And I understand that there's not a lot of people. There may not. Some people may not know me or my ministry and are a little bit iffy of it. But one thing you got to keep in mind: where I got that fundraiser on Indiegogo. Indiegogo goes through a lot of verification processes to make sure that these people are, that everybody that does a fundraiser are who they say they are on it. So it's not just your own risk type thing. The money originally will go in the Indiegogo account, and if you donate, and it'll eventually wind up in an account that I have set up for the strictly for JesusFest. And I will be posting videos of that God willing that thing happens. I will post videos on it. I mean, there was a little short time there that I did try to open up ticket sales and did it a little bit too early. I got a little bit of misinformation on that, when I could start, and was corrected on it. And so I took it all down and suspended ticket sales for now, until I get the proper paperwork into the booking agency. I did a little bit before I had the proper paperwork in, because somebody within the booking agency told me I could. And I found out otherwise later. And anybody that saw that, and I apologize for that. And so that's another thing, a Christian thing to do too. Like I said, I'm not perfect. I make mistakes. That was one of my mistakes. And as a Christian, we're supposed to correct our mistakes when we make them, and that's what I did. So again, I just want to thank everybody for watching. And be looking forward to hearing from those that wanna give me a shout, that wanna comment or whatever, with your questions, your comments or whatever. Even if you wanna make a contribution to JesusFest and or the ministry, feel free to do so. I don't ask or require anybody to do to do such. It's all based on what God leads you to do on that. I'm not gonna sit there and tell you that you're gonna go to hell because you don't contribute, because that's a flat out lie. A lot of churches get into all that stuff, and that's a lie. and I'll even do a video on that later on, and that as far as, you know, the proper ways of tithing and offering and such, and it's and whether or not we're commanded to tithe this day and time. And just a real quick answer on that. No, we're not commanded to tithe this day and time. I don't frown on it. Don't get me wrong. I don't frown on tithes and offerings and stuff. And for sure not the offering. But a lot of people teach that tithing this day is commanded, and it's not. Nowhere in the New Testament does it say it's a commandment. I mean, it's a willful act is what it is, and it's not nothing that's going to, whether you do or don't, is irrelevant to whether you're going to go to heaven or whether you're doing, and or whether you or not you're going to get to heaven and stuff. And I'll get into that on another video later. That being said, I just want to thank everybody for watching. I've already closed out the service at first prayer. Kind of did that backwards. God led that backwards for some reason. I don't know why, but. But everybody have a blessed day. And I'm doing this at night over here, so have a blessed day if you're across seas, and have a good night over here in the U.S. And God bless you in Jesus' name.